What do you like about Sakurai and his body of work, Imran?
He has an attention to detail that I don't think is matched by pretty much anybody else. Like, we were talking about Isabel earlier, how, like, oh, she's the most strongest character or whatever. People have noticed in the footage that came out from the previous stuff was that every time Isabel, like, does a knockout hit to somebody, she has, like, a mortified or, like, pained look on her face. Because she doesn't want to hurt them.
Yeah,
that's a touch of detail you wouldn't get from pretty much any other developer.
I'm totally with you. Yeah, Brian, I sent this to you, like the game explain video. It's a long process, but in the World of Light cinematic, when everyone's being Avengers Infinity Ward away and stuff, nobody could figure out why Wii Fit Trainer does like this bizarre yoga pose. And it turns out because in the last game, when she did that pose, there was like a couple frames of invincibility. So that's her trying to like hit at just the right moment so she isn't whisked away by the mysterious light coming towards them.
So on that same topic.
My favorite one was Bayonetta, who in the game she can only dodge from one enemy 3 times within 1 second. In the trailer, she does that, and then on the third hit, she gets hit.
That's so good.
That's such a deep cut that it's like, I'm a Bayonetta, I don't know what I want to say expert, but I'm really into that game.
Yeah.
I barely noticed that.
Yeah, you're the next Lady Gaga when it comes to Bayonetta fandom. It's confusing, yeah.
So on that same topic and attention to detail, I actually spoke with Sakurai right after playing the Smash Brothers session.
Are you kidding me? He was there?
He was not there. It was over email.
Spoke is a
fine, fine.
High word here.
I asked Sakurai some questions, and he responded to them.
You got that email
directly.
Back?
I did. You can read it on GameInformer.com right now.
Oh my God.
And I asked him like how the team is so like meticulous with their attention to detail. And basically he said that he was like, you know, you'd be surprised by how poorly just trying to remain like faithful to everything that other developers have done works for something like this. So what they do is they basically take exaggerations and just embellish them in the style. Because if you remain faithful, he didn't say this, it's kind of like putting words in his mouth, but if you remain faithful to all these different characters coming together, like it just wouldn't work. So they all studied the characters like super in depth and then find things to embellish on the characters and exaggerate on in order to like make them only like have like this attention to detail, but also fit into the style of Smash Brothers.
Yeah. When Mizuguchi was on from Tetris Effect fame not too long ago, we asked him what he was like working with Sakurai on Meteos. And it's interesting that the first thing he said is like he has a crazy attention to detail and how at the start of a project, he knows exactly what it's going to be like to experience the finished project and all the little details that you have to get right along the way and how people are going to be feeling about all these things, which is strange because looking back at Old Iwata Asks, which I did a lot of reading Old Iwata Asks.
Yeah, I think
reminded,
we all read there's a good Brawl one in particular.
Yeah, there's several good ones. And his one on Kid Icarus Uprising is also really good, but those Iwata Asks are just the best. But Iwata had the same take, which is interesting. Here's a quote from Iwata talking about what's so great about Sakurai, saying...
I have the same exact one right now.
Oh, really? Okay. my decision to pursue the project in this way, talking about Smash Brothers Brawl, on one point, rested on one point and one point alone, and it is deeply tied to the point about which I have the utmost faith in a man named Masahiro Sakurai. To state it simply, you are capable of taking a project with nothing and visualizing a completed game almost perfectly in your head. I don't know how, but you're able to visualize a game right down to its very details, as if the finished game is working inside your mind. If not, how else could you have been right so many times? I love Iwata just being flummoxed. But like, how are you seeing this? How are you seeing exactly what's going to go right and wrong with the entire project?
And his knowledge of like a lot of the Nintendo stuff specifically is like super impressive because there was a Guardian interview where they talked to him about like, so like you guys must have like a research team that comes up and like looks at all these references and puts them in the game. He's like, no, like a lot of that stuff is just from me of things that I already know.
Right.
And like want to put in the game. Like it is insane how like... how knowledgeable he is about games. Because you think about most game developers, like once they start making games, they sort of like say, well, I haven't had time to play any games because I've been so busy working on them. But like how well he's kept up with games is like super impressive.
He's still playing Wii Fit just for research.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. We had a while ago, I still consider this an honor because I'm a dumb Sakurai dork, but for the development of the Wii U and 3DS versions, he did the equivalent of what he's been doing with Famitsu forever, of doing these little dev diaries, and he did it in Game Informer. He wrote in like four entries.
I think it was four, yeah.
Right? And then the last one, we got to ask him questions. And so one of the questions I really want to get in there is, I'll just read it verbatim because I'm a maniac. The Smash Brothers games are packed with so much information on Nintendo's history. Do you just consider this fun trivia? What importance is there in teaching younger generations about Nintendo's and gaming's history? And he says, I've been playing the NES since I was a grade schooler, just after it came out in Japan. I've walked hand in hand with the history of gaming since, so I have a great deal of knowledge in that field. However, I'm frankly also getting old. Simply retelling stories from the past will make me sound like a doddering old man rambling to a disinterested crowd. So I think it's necessary to strike a fair balance between the past and present. So he's like, oh, no, I just put it in there. I guess some people might think that it even looks like an old game being a side-scroller, but eh, not so much.
Yeah.
Wasn't as insightful as I was hoping for. I was hoping that was like his mission to inform people, because I always make the case every Smash Brothers game is like the best Nintendo interactive documentary you could ever hope for. Every single release. It's just mind-boggling. What did you learn about Sakurai, Kyle?
I was impressed. That Guardian interview was very good. I read that as well. And him talking about like his just personal collection of video games, I found really fascinating. Like how he makes time to play games. And he was even saying like, my personal collection of video games is so vast that like I can't even think about displaying them. Like it's ridiculous. I need to start buying digital games because I don't even have room for it anymore. And I get the sense that like he really plays everything and loves everything and just considers everything research. Like when he was first starting, he said he had like a part-time job that he took while he was in engineering school expressly to buy video games and play video games. And he looked at that as research. He wasn't just like some super fan, like, oh, I want to play all these. He's like, I am doing research because I want to make video games, you know, which I thought was really interesting.
Yeah, just learning about like the history of Smash in particular. There's fun stories of him talking about playing Street Fighter 2 in the arcade and playing a lot of fighting games or trying to play modern fighting games. It's like, I just can't keep up with this. But I wonder if he still is compelled to try and play current fighting games just for research, or if that's just cat's out of the bag, it's out the window at this point, F it.
And you'd be surprised at how much of like Smash is influenced by some of that stuff. Because he was talking about some like super deep dive stuff, but like he was talking about how there are certain, like in Ultimate, there's a thing where if you, I think, press the button and do an attack, they'll do sort of like a smaller jump. And that's like straight up something that you can do in KOF, of like you have these little short hops versus long jumps and being able to do that, and like sort of the way that the roll, the evasive roll, is sort of nerfed in this. And because he says, oh, you know, we wanted to make, you know, we wanted to prevent people from like being evasive. And that's also something that is in Guilty Gear, of like if you move backwards long enough, you start getting a penalty to your meter. So like how like people think about sort of Sakurai is like, oh, I make the casual fighting games, but he is knee deep in that stuff as well, of like,
really? Thinking, you think so?
Well, I don't think he's like, you know, out there following like, you know, like the competitive scene or anything, but I think he thinks about a lot of the same things that traditional fighting game developers do.
We know he's like an amazing Street Fighter player, right? Or at least was when he was younger.
It was King of Fighters 95.
And Street Fighter as well, right?
Yeah.
Street Fighter 2. He won a 100-man tournament, I think.
Yeah.
That's awesome. I love the idea of him. In some interview I read, I wish I could remember which one, but he talked about watching competitive play for Smash, and he's like, it's kind of, they need to vary it up a little bit more.
More items. I would like to see them use more items.
Exactly, which is funny, because talking about like the history of Smash Brothers again, he said that one of the things he wanted to do was come up with like a fighting game where people weren't just like entrenched in their own combos and their own rhythms, but to have like an ad-lib flavor. That's something that kept coming up again and again in the Iwata ass. I was like, I want these players to like improvise while playing a fighting game, just to shake things up constantly.
Yeah, but he there was a thing about Bayonetta, about how implementing her meant like in Bayonetta the game, a lot of it is combo based, of like I do these specific things and they work every time. And he said that's something he specifically didn't want to be the case in Smash Brothers. He didn't want the same combos to work over, like he did want that improvisation of like, we don't want the same combos to like to work every time you use them. And a lot of that is just like I mentioned, King of Fighters 95, because he has that anecdote about how he was playing very seriously against someone against him, and then he looked over, because you can't see the other player in like Japanese arcades, so he looks over, and then like the other person's like, I think there with I think it was his partner, and they were just kind of like having fun and like kind of like palling around, and he was taking it very seriously, and he just thought like, I bet that person's like having more fun.
Well, yeah, because like, he totally wiped the floor with them.
Yeah.
And he was like, well, it's interesting to me that his first thought was like, oh, they probably didn't have fun.
Yeah.
It's like, aren't you happy that you won? It's like, now for Sakurai, it's like, I want everyone to have fun and like be able to get the hang of this game right away.
It's so it's really like interesting to see how that specific moment, it like can act as like, if you were making a documentary about him, could act as a through line of like him always wanting to make sort of the style of competitive game more accessible to people.
Right.
Which also like Smash is the best-selling fighting game out there, period. You kind of have to make concessions for a more casual audience, because like the reason it sells so well is because anyone could pick it up and play.
Yeah, I mean, that was in that Iwata asks, or maybe a different one, that was one of the things that both Iwata and Sakurai expressed interest in with the original Smash Brothers, was we wanted to make a game that was kind of a response to the hardcore scene, in that like it's not all about like technical ability or anything. It's just something that anybody could pick up and within 10 minutes of playing have as much fun with with the game as like somebody who's been playing for hours or even years.
And then Iwata asked, has like an old early image of the prototype before it was Nintendo characters in there. And I guess like Iwata programmed this thing by hand in his free time after hours. But here's the quote about the origin, right? Sakurai says, well, I wanted to offer an alternative to two-dimensional fighting games that were crowding out the market. I also wanted to see if it was possible to make an interesting four-player game that offered a new experience every time you play. Simply put, I was aiming to design a four-player battle royale. Iwata says, I seem to remember four-player battle royale being written on the cover of the project planning document.
Yeah.
And then, oh, he also has a weird take talking about like why they decided to include Nintendo characters in there. And this is what Sakurai says. He says, with a game for the arcade, it's okay for character development to take a backseat since players are content with the fighting. With a fighting game for the home console, however, you have to set up your general image or the atmosphere of the gaming world right from the start or else the game suffers. That's why I asked to use the Nintendo characters. That's such a weird idea to think of like the home console. Well, you need to have character first and foremost. And they talked about like the number of arms they had to, you know, twist and stuff just to this happen and get those Nintendo characters in there, and how there was, it was controversial because like, I don't think people are going to want to see Luigi beating up Mario. This is going to, people
disgusting.
Are going to riot in
I
the street.
I only want to see Luigi beating up Mario.
Yeah, now it just seems so obvious.
I will say at the time I was such a Zelda super fan that I was like, man, I don't know if I want Link in one of these Nintendo party games.
Really?
Yeah, like I really felt that way. And then I played it and fell in love with it. But
it turns out it's great. And the code name, they said a couple things. It was Ryuo, I think, for a while, and then it was also called Dragon King : The Fighting Game.
Well, that's like the translation of it.
Yeah.
Of Ryuo?
Of Kakuda.
Don't even
something.
Try.
Well, Ryuo is the neighborhood.
Yeah, but
that's in the background image of like the test case. Yeah,
of where
sure.
the studio was.
But
where
in that official transcript, they just translated that completely.
Yeah, okay.
Gotcha.
Yeah.
Dragon King.
And also with the early take on people being a little bit weirded out by Nintendo characters in there, Sakurai at some point in the Iwata ask said, quote, we even wrote an quote-unquote ultimate manual to try and persuade interest. I like the idea of the ultimate word now coming back for the full circle. Yeah.
There's that story about how Miyamoto was originally not on board with the idea, and then Iwata told him, just do it anyway. Like,
make a prototype
with the Nintendo characters. And so when they brought it in, Miyamoto was like, yeah, sure, I guess you can do it.
That's the trick. That's what Ubisoft did with
People tell you not to.
With Mario Rabbids, they brought in like a prototype with a Mario model that they had made and inserted into the game, and Miyamoto was so impressed. They're like, go ahead and make it.
Miyamoto is like on a logical basis, like super against the idea, and then every time he sees it, like, that's Mario, man.
That's got little rascals in that game. That seems great.
So that's what those fans...
Never just ask him first, just show him the thing.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
That's what all those fan developers are doing wrong. They're throwing it on the internet instead of showing it to Miyamoto first. Yeah.
There was an interesting quote. I love reading that and just feeling the relationship of like crazy respect between Iwata and Sakurai back in the day, coming up from HAL together. But there's a great quote where Iwata said something like, look, we're going to fail if we keep just trying to make the games that Miyamoto wants to make. And at HAL, we should try and do something a little bit differently. And then that led to them creating the Battle Royale, when they invented Battle Royales, I think, with the original.
And also, like, the kind of like the blown away feeling that Iwata had when he was like, how old were you when you started this? And he was like, I was 19 when I joined HAL. And it's like,
you were 19?
So,
and that's when they created Kirby too. Yeah.
The Kirby days.
Have you guys seen that image, though, of like when Kirby first launched? It was a picture of Miyamoto, Iwata, and Sakurai.
No.
They each drew Kirby on the image. And like Miyamoto and Sakurai had like very nice ones. And Sakurai also looked like, being 20, he looks exactly the same as he does now.
Yeah, right.
But he doesn't age at all.
Iwata had like this really awful like three circles and like... Just like he clearly could not draw, it was clearly programmer art.
Programmer art, yeah. Are you guys big Kirby guys?
I like Kirby.
I like Kirby just fine. Yeah, like the first couple games, I played a fair amount and whatnot and play them here and again. But it's weird being a big Sakurai fan, and I don't feel like I've at least found the interview of him like diving deep on Kirby's game design.
Yeah. I mean, after 2003, he was like out of HAL, so it was, you know, any recent game he has no involvement
with. Well, he did say that from the start, Kirby was meant to be kind of like a game for beginners at a time when NES games were very difficult. And he was like, well, I want to make every game could be somebody's... Everyone was a casual gamer at some point. I want to make a game that like any casual gamer can play and get the hang of and enjoy. And then maybe that will take them to the next step. And I think that's what he wanted for Kirby. And I think he achieved it.
I think the first time I ever saw Kirby was in Smash Brothers, actually.
Really?
Really?
Yeah. I think I might be with you, actually.
Really?
Yeah.
Do you guys play the Game Boy Dreamland or anything?
No.
I didn't play Dreamland until later, but I'd seen Superstar.
Yeah,
I think that and like F-Zero was like the first time I had like Smash Brothers introduced me to the idea of F-Zero.
Especially NES.
That was my first Captain Falcon experience.
NES as well,
I genuinely, I was so stupid. I thought NES was a reference to like the NES, which maybe ultimately it is in the localization, but I thought, like, is this like a personification of the console? Like, I don't know what I'm looking at here. What is Earthbound? What are you talking about?
And speaking of Kirby, there's I read an interview from that was in like the old strategy guide. To like I think Kirby's Adventure, and Iwata mentioned that like before we settled on the name Kirby, he was originally called Twinkle Popo.
That's so good.
And then he has a story about in that interview as well about how I guess Sakurai drew the first time he drew him like to share with the team was in black and white, and everyone thought he was a different color. Like people thought he was like black and white. People thought he was yellow, and that's why he's black and white on that one box in the box art.
Oh, okay.
That's kind
of
great.
Yeah, and then he ends, and then like most of those like colors ended up being like Kirby's alternate colors in Smash Brothers.
Right. Oh, I love the black and white Kirby. I think he looks so cool in Smash.
It wasn't
Sparkle Popo.
I'm sorry. Yeah. Popo.
I think that's I read that Kirby was just a placeholder until like they came up with an actual character.
Oh yeah.
I'm pretty sure I read that.
I'd believe it. I mean, he really is so simple.
That's all right. The point of this podcast is vaguely just, remember the things you read. So I think that totally fits. Did you guys play Kirby's Air Ride?
No.
I played a little bit of it.
I played a little bit of it too. Yeah.
GameCube, right?
Yes. Okay. GameCube racing game where it's insane because you hold down A to slow down.
Because you go automatically.
Right. You go automatically and it's all just about like managing drift and stuff like that. And so here's some quotes about that, by the way, about like what he was going for. Because they also talk about Kid Icarus Uprising, which we can talk about a little bit. But Sakurai says, that's part of my style, you might say. I think more people are starting to pick up on it. They do like simplifying the controls. And Iwata says, what exactly is your style, sir?
Did he say it so condescendingly?
No. He's a very sweet man. And Sakurai says, not just Super Smash Bros., but the Kirby Air Ride and Meteos games are like that as well. Iwata says, like, the more you chew it, the more flavor comes out. It's a weird way of phrasing. Sorry, I'll stop critiquing this. Sakurai says, rather, since the rules are so different from convention, people who are especially used to games may have a difficult time comprehending it at first. Iwata says, trying it a little isn't enough to immediately understand how fun it is, right? And then Sakurai just goes on and talks about how, like, the core of his idea of game design is disassembly and reassembly. So taking racing games with Kirby's Air Ride, stripping everything out, like, where is the fun actually hiding here? And in his mind, he's like, it's drifting around corners. Everything else has got to go. It's got to have that risk and reward of drifting around corners. But even the concept of accelerating, there's nothing inherently fun with that. It's got to go.
Yeah. And it's interesting, like, because we normalize it now, but, like, think about how weird the idea of a fighting game based on the idea of, like, you have to knock them out of the screen. Like,
right.
They have to no longer be on screen, and then they will die versus, like, just deplete their health bar. Like, think about, like, how different that was from other games at the time.
Yeah. Right. And then Iwata hasn't even talked about, like, no one understood what we're going for and why that would inherently be more fun and give you more opportunities.
Yeah. The percentage system took me a while to wrap my head around. I was very confused by it for a long time.
Oh, yeah.
Probably. I think somebody explained it to me as sumo, and I was like, oh, now I get it.
Sumo?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
it's
basically sumo. It's just knocking the other opponent just out.
Oh, yeah.
Huh.
Yeah, I guess I could see that. That checks out. Did you guys play Kid Icarus?
Which one?
Yes.
Not much.
Uprising.
No. I tried to play Uprising, but that was one of those games where I really liked the concept of it, but just hated the controls. Like, I just could not play that game. Like, I never...
That is the problem. The game is fantastically designed. It's just, the controls are bad.
Switch version.
It'd be nice to see something. I'm totally with you where I got maybe halfway through that, and I appreciate like the writing and the music. Like, there's a lot of really great stuff in there. It's just... you came with the dumb stand that you had to like put your 3DS on. And then I remember even playing when Jeff Cork was doing the review that battle mode, which in the Iwata asked, they're like, this is basically Smash Brothers in 3D, or as close as we're going to get realistically to making Smash Brothers in 3D. And it was okay, but still just running around that space frantically using those controls. It was just so rough. It's a bummer too, because you look at like Sakurai's career, he hasn't made that much. It's Kirby, Smash, Kirby's Air Ride, Meteos, and Kid Icarus. And I feel like Kid Icarus was that shot for doing something new when he had branched out.
Getting away from Smash Brothers for a little while.
Yeah, for sure. Just getting away from all Nintendo stuff. And he said that they wanted to make a game about like flying around and like air combat. And then at some point, it was like, well, we should probably revive an old Nintendo thing. That's easy. Or makes it easier to sell. And then here we go, Kid Icarus. Let's connect them.
Yeah.
Also, you're forgetting he voices King Dedede.
That's right.
Oh, yeah. You know what? That's a great point. True. Yeah, that is absolutely crucial.
That's where he sates his creative thirst.
Makes sense.
Voicing this penguin.
I feel like more than any developer in the industry, Sakurai has this, what's the word I'm looking for?
Youthfulness?
Pathos? Or something, right?
Like for his work ethic?
I think everyone just always feels like, oh, poor Sakurai. Like, yeah, liberate that guy.
He's mythologized. like somehow his work ethic has been mythologized more than, like, most game developers.
Yeah, and also, sure. Like, he had that thing in the Smash Direct. Like, sometimes I wonder if I'll ever get to take a break. Yeah.
Right.
When they announced the DLC.
He slowly raises the gun to his head. Yeah. It's too much, but they're having fun.
Like, that sigh lasted long enough to where you know it was intentional.
That's certainly him leaning into that, but I think a lot of that comes from, like, him writing frankly about developing games in Famitsu and even talking about his injuries related to his hand.
Yeah.
Here's what he said. Very honest. 2013 in Famitsu. I think the one word I've said the most this year by far is ow. Not only am I getting calcific tendonitis.
He stumbled over it in the Famitsu article as well.
But they've also found what are apparently several ruptures in the muscles. My upper arm hurts and there's this chronic dull pain in my elbow joint as well. On the lower arm, there's this feeling of fatigue around the flexor muscles that turns into pain when I use a keyboard or game controller with my fingers.
Yeah, and but he has to use a special mouse.
That's true. This is a development for that game. But then talking about the new Smash, apparently, was it Bill Trinan? Told you, Kyle.
Yeah, I was talking about E3, yeah.
Yeah, he said, quote, Sakurai's totally fine. I think he had risk issues during the development of the Wii U game. He's fine now. My understanding is he got over it.
Don't inquire further.
Man.
Don't.
He's fine. Don't worry about
it.
Yeah,
there's a thing in like a Source Gaming that said like, oh yeah, for this one, he's taking a special schedule. He's working 10 hours a day and has 2 days off. You know, a regular person's work week is this huge exception this for him.
I also saw something that like Melee, he worked like 40 hours straight and like didn't take like a Saturday off for like or like
Melee
any holidays.
8 months. It was
like for months on end. He worked like these long, long days, no holidays, no Saturdays off, and like that was how his life was for like several months.
And he's talked about like trying to offload some duties, like designing characters and all that stuff to other people, and it's like it just never goes well. I don't like doing it. And it's like he is a genius. He can keep the game in his head, but at some point, man, for your own health.
Yeah.
That's what I'm saying. No other game developer, I feel like, are people as concerned about. And is it part of like the marketing spiel of a new Smash? Is like,
it's
that guy's really killing himself.
It's such
this
a
one,
conflicted thing, yeah. Because like, there was also like this quote in the virtual where he said, like, I don't think I've ever made something that I'm totally satisfied with, he says. That feeling of doubt or wanting to do more is my engine to move forward and make the next iteration.
Oh, his just general thing just seems to be like, no, you guys don't understand.
It's not
like,
enough.
The fact that this game came out is a freaking miracle. Right. Like, it doesn't, you guys don't understand how difficult this is. Like, it's like Mario Punch and Zelda.
He also brought up that miracle thing in my interview with him. But I asked him about, like, his responsibility in creating, like, all, like, the CG reveal trailers and all the other stuff.
Oh, I'm so into it, yes.
And he said, I create all the plots, including that of World of Light. I make dense adjustment requests to the CG staff, and I also review things like the audio. I, of course, take a look at the gameplay portions as well. And then he goes on to say, thinking in terms of game development, I should probably entrust this all to someone, but I haven't really found that someone yet.
Keep searching, man. Because isn't there a story that like he married the UI designer?
It's not a story. Yes. That's his wife.
That is his wife.
Well,
yeah,
isn't everything in life just a story? Right? Yeah, one of your fact stories you keep talking about.
Michiko Sakurai. She was a designer on Kirby Star Stacker and Kirby 64, and she does all like the menu designs. And I guess maybe you know something about this, Imran. I was reading online that she helped found Sora, but I haven't found a lot of evidence to support that.
And you want to explain what Sora is?
So Sora is just Sakurai and his wife. They're basically like a freelance thing, and like it doesn't really, I mean, the company kind of just doesn't exist that much. Sakurai is technically not an employee of either Bandai or Nintendo. He's an employee of Sora, which is the company he owns. So it's just he hires his wife to work on the UI for these games. That's pretty much it.
It's beautiful.
It's odd that it's the freelance angle is so odd to me that like he's not like employed by a developer ultimately.
No,
like he just kind of freelances. I don't quite understand the business side of it, but
that's Polygon.
I think like he doesn't like working for big companies anymore. Like apparently there was something happening with Kirby's Air Ride that that's why he quit Nintendo. And then
HAL because he wasn't. It's weird because he did not like seeing what was going on with Kirby, how he was just being sequelized,
mm-hmm.
which is interesting because now
he's
working
stuck
on Smash
in that rhythm forever.
It seems like
Well, I mean, Polygon had a story. Help me out if you guys remember, but just like the growing trend in Japan specifically of like these creators like Mizuguchi we referenced earlier and like Ueda, they just formed the concept team, right? Or Concept, I guess if you want to be literal there. So they just formed their own roaming team and then just connected different developers individually to create these games. It's a weird structure that doesn't really exist in the West as far as I can think.
Yeah, and
maybe some indies, but
another thing that Sakurai brought up going to that freelance idea was that like every game leading up to Ultimate since Melee has been made by a different development team.
Right.
So like HAL made the first two games, so N64 and Melee, then Brawl was made just by a team of freelancers.
A Game Ace that started Game Arts, from, yes.
And then
they made an RPG, but I don't remember the name.
You know, they made Grandia. Like they went directly from working on Grandia 3 to working on Brawl, which is like, oh, I didn't even
think
of that connection. Yeah.
And then Bandai Namco was with Wii U and 3DS. So like this is the first time since Melee that he's had like the steady team going from one entry to the next.
Yeah. Do you guys think this is the end for Smash? Well, the end for Sakurai Smash?
No.
Really?
I think he's always gonna be involved. I don't know that how much longer he has to direct these games, like at some point, health is going to be an overriding concern.
Yeah, by the way, I want him to take a break. I just don't. He just seems to, I mean, genuinely seems to enjoy making video games so much that I don't think he wants to slow down.
He said, I think it was in the Guardian interview, they asked him something about, like, are you one of those people that never wants to retire? You want to keep making games forever? He's like, no. Definitely not. Yeah.
Well, I asked him.
And he
him,
wants to do more consulting and get away from directing.
I asked him straight up about the meaning of the word ultimate in the Western version of Super Smash Brothers Ultimate. And his response was, I said, like, you know, it can mean the best version of something, but it can also mean like final or the end of something. And he said, with the background I explained here, which he get in a previous answer about like how miraculous it is that they make any Smash Brothers games.
Yeah, is that right?
Every time when I work on this game, I've devoted myself to making it under the assumption this is the last one. That said, I have no idea what the future holds, so I can't deny that there's no next one either. He said in the past that like, yeah, I think this might be the last one, but it seems like that's what he goes into the development of every Smash Brothers game with.
Right, with
mindset.
The mentality.
I will
of
say
like,
that there does seem to be some stuff, like some more hints now that he's kind of done with it. Like when they did that DLC announcement, he's like, please stop giving us feedback, we don't want any more.
Right,
like, I could definitely see like, okay, we're done, we can't do this anymore with the way the audience works.
And he's talked about, I think it was in the Brawl, a lot of asked about like how we're just adding more and more characters. If we ever shook up the core game design, we'd have to strip out some of the characters because we just can't keep it out. And I feel like that's where it has to go. You can't top, in theory, Ultimate, unless it's a disaster when it launches, but it won't be. Right? Like, what do you do? I think having that soft reboot of Smash, I'm not saying go back down to 6 or 8 or whatever the hell it was, but get back down to like 15 characters and maybe go 3D. Like, do something just to make it a clear line of the sand and he can just stand back and consult, jump up at E3 every once in a while, and that's
make his own Death Stranding.
Hell yeah. Don't you want to see it? I want to see more original ideas from this guy.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I don't know, a 3D Smash.
That seems like a good idea, too.
Yeah, just keep supporting this one for a couple years.
Yeah.
A 3D Smash just sounds like a nightmare to me. Maybe because I haven't played that many good 3D fighting games in general, like full-on 3D.
Right. Well, it doesn't have to be that necessarily. Maybe it can be like a Tekken 3D. What do you call that there, Surreal?
Tekken.
Yeah. Tekken style.
Well, then, like, even, like, Pokken Tournament, I'm not a big fan of. And, like, I should love that game.
Yeah, that's right. Shay doesn't like those things.
You should, though.
The other things I appreciate about Sakurai.
His hair.
You mentioned a little bit, like, the trailers, I think, recently have just been
unbelievable.
So much fun. The cinematography.
So many misdirections, too.
But the crazy thing is, I was like, God, I need to go back and experience Subspace Emissary again, because it's been so long since I played that. I watched those cutscenes. Not that good. Not as good as I remember. Like, there's fun little moments there, but a lot of it's just kind of like dry, no music. And compared to like
a lot of characters looking at each other, nodding in agreement.
Yes,
right?
Exactly. And compared to like the personality that's just oozing out of the last couple games trailers, Subspace Emissary cutscenes, not so great.
Yeah, and World of Light does not lean on cutscenes that heavily.
Good.
It's more about like just collecting all those spirits and like reuniting the entire huge roster of characters.
Yeah. Yeah.
But there will be some cutscenes, so don't think that like that intro cinematic is all we're going to get.
I get it. I also really appreciate Sakurai for just Nintendo being a company overall that's very locked down. It likes presenting a nice little clean game and giving it to you. And the Sakurai, it's like, here's as many options as we can possibly give you, which seems to just be the antithesis of Nintendo design, and to shove it in this most Nintendo-ass game of all time, right? I just love that idea. And then even beyond that, even just being as transparent as they've been, like launching that Smash Dojo website, which I would refresh every single day in the build up to Brawl, and just trying to be transparent with what I can only imagine is one of the most unreasonable fan bases in the world. Like, that is such a bold move. No wonder you get burned out.
And like even the Smash Ultimate, like the full reveal at E3 was like, here are 100 changes we're making, like on like a right. micro level. Like, all right, Mario now has this amount of damage instead of this amount of damage on his up yeah. special.
A lot of the non
like,
Smash
crap.
A lot of the non Smash fans on staff were like, "What am I even watching?
Right.
What are we doing?"
It's like, "Yeah, I like Smash Brothers, but what?"
And then the Smash fans had even more questions. We're like, "Why didn't you go into yeah, that menu? Yeah.
Where's Geno? You didn't put my favorite guy yes, in the game."
What a nightmare! Oh my god. I like learning about how he chooses characters and stuff in the Game Informer Dev Diaries. You wrote a little bit about that, and he had this line where he talks about. How, okay, let's see. First, I sat in a fighter, visualize their moves, snap poses using action figures, and bring that over to the spec crew as I work on frame timings. The general stats for moves, their speed, reach, other traits are more or less decided by this point. I then give instructions to the motion designers, and once they bring back animation for me, I directly program attack, hitboxes, and such. Once a fighter is playable to some extent, I unleash them on the test players and then get that data. But he does. He has these little action figures that are super poseable. I just love the idea of him, like, okay, who do we got here? Simon Belmont.
He's
and
got a whip. Okay.
Pose kind of like this, and then just walking it across the office and setting it down for the designers.
Someone get me a piece of string. I need the whip.
Yeah, that's such a weird idea, but yeah. Smash, one of the best.
Yeah, super talented developer, genius.
Kyle says he's very good at his job.
Liberate his spirit for the love of God. Yeah.
And if you want to read more about Sakurai or Super Smash Bros. Ultimate, GameInformer.com has you covered.
Oh.
Giant feature about my 4 or 5 hours with Super Smash Brothers.
We just want that interview, though.
And also the interview.
Okay, great.
Yeah, both of them on.
You can get them both on the same site. You don't have to
yeah,
pay separate.
You don't even have to leave sites. GameInformer.com for both.
Also, if you search, like, probably Sakurai Game Informer Dev Diaries, maybe it'll be in there. But you can see what Nintendo really built up is a big deal about, we'll show you Sakurai's desk.
Ooh.
You can see his workstation for the Wii U game. It is out of this world. Fans,
we don't want to hype it up too much.
Fans,
but
of
you
desks,
want to check this out.
You will cry. Especially if you like cat calendars and clean, empty desks.
That was just a clip from a larger show called The Game Informer Show. You can find it on iTunes, Google Play, or GameInformer.com. We take the fun opportunities and exclusive information from Game Informer Magazine and boil it into a show that airs every Thursday with exclusive cover story information, developer interviews, a lot of fun stuff. So come love games with us.